congratulations. You guys are my advanced students, therefore you get more.
What?
More?
More?
These are the additional study guide questions for passing state test number 3-2. What is the rule you should not break regarding the 180 degree line? Remember talking about this? So they're suggesting here, we've got two people talking. It looks like they're playing cards across a card table. You got a camera here, here, here. That's all fine. But this is the 180 degree line. If you're shooting from this direction, and let's say that we'll call this guy Jim and this guy Bob. So Jim says, all right, I'll see you and raise you one or something. And so we're looking over Jim's shoulder, and then we look over Bob's shoulder, and he's looking at his cards, and he's thinking, well, I got four aces. Maybe I should add to that. We're playing a game of poker. So that's all fine as we watch it. But what would happen if all of a sudden we jumped a camera on the other side, and we go from Jim saying that to Bob, and then we cut to this side, Bob saying that to Jim. Imagine playing tennis. The tennis ball goes over. The guy returns it, and you're watching the game just fine. And then the tennis ball goes over, but then you switch cameras to the other side of the court, and the guy returns it from the same side he was just on. You're like, that doesn't make any sense. He hit the ball, we'll say, right to left, and all of a sudden he's returning the ball right to left. Soccer, football, basketball, any sport, if you were to screw up that 180 degree line, you'd throw a pass. And then if you switch cameras to the other side of the field, you'd throw the pass, and the ball would come right back, only this time a receiver's catching it, and he's running it into the wrong end zone.
7:30, Cavs live. Pushing, 6:30, back the other way, LeBron James. Pushing, 6:30, back the other way, LeBron James.
Don't cross the line. And don't cross the line with me either. Some of you guys, you think you can cross the line with me? You're gonna get detention. All right, all the cuts. Transitioning from one shot to another to show continuous action. That's called a match cut. It can be an action like going out a door. You go out to the sidewalk and city street and they're coming out the door. That would be a match cut. I'm going to show you some examples. They're better than me trying to pantomime it. That's a match cut. They're used all the time. Transitioning from one shot to another to construct the location. So this is when you're telling people what location you're in. They call that a spatial cut. Spelled weird. Should be spelled like outer space or you're in this space. But they put a T in there because it's English. It has to be hard. A spatial cut. And here's what it looks like. Transitioning between shots to control the film's pace. That's called a rhythmic cut. Rhythm. And the galloping horses are getting closer and closer. Bet you can't spell rhythmic on your own. It's such a weird word. I understand you can actually drop out the H or something like that. But anyway, that's the way they want us to spell it. A rhythmic cut. And if you got music going along and you cut on the beat, that's also a rhythmic cut and it's very useful. So, you know, you got some drums pounding, and let's say that soldiers are coming up a hill, and you cut to a soldier, and you cut to another soldier. Now you cut to a whole bunch of them, and they happen to be marching in time with my drumming. But anyway, every time you do a cut like that, it's called cutting to the beat.
Thank you.
everybody see this one, but I'm not going to be scrolling it, so you just have to pay attention here. Transitions that alter the audience's perception of time. That's happening so much. Christopher Nolan loves to do it. Everyone does flashbacks. If you've seen Dunkirk, you were thrown for a loop for like the first 30 minutes of the film. What is going on? Because he just kept cutting around. But he is the master of temporal cuts. So this is what temporal cuts look like.
I gotta be honest, when I first watched Dunkirk, I didn't understand that each storyline is taking place within a different time span. He set up this clearly with the slate, but it completely went over my head. And I think that's true for many people watching the film.
The story begins in 1981, with Forrest sitting on a bus bench before he begins rambling to strangers about the surreal events of his adventurous life.
And so then I got a call from him saying, we don't have to worry about money no more. And I said, that's good. One less thing.
It results in emotions of all sorts, from humor to heartbreak, and provides a greatest hits account of recent American history, educating and inciting nostalgic stirrings at the same time.
I had never seen anything so beautiful in my life.
Okay, those are the cuts they want you to know for the state test. Those are the added ones to what you already knew how to do, especially the jump cut. That's a little joke. What is DOF? Department of Forests. I don't know. Depth of field. I give you all the answers. What is depth of field? It's what's in focus. Do I want just this flower to be in focus to you, and then by the time you see the screen, it's already blurry in the background? That's a pretty cool cinematography trick. Well, the way that you adjust that depth of focus, whether this is in focus or everywhere from here to delta's in focus, a great depth of field or just a shallow depth of field. The way you adjust that is with your aperture or your iris. I call it both of them. In film photography, in motion video, I should say. In motion video, we almost always call it an iris on a camera. It's the round opening that lets the light into the camera, okay? And you can stop that all the way down and let very little light into the camera, or you can open it up larger. But in still photography, guess what we usually call it? Aperture. I don't know what they call it on the state test, so I use both. And if you've had my photography class, you're used to calling it aperture, but get used to calling it iris, because now you're on motion video cameras. So the iris, and then also how close you are to the subject. Let's use this flower again. So you can control that depth of field by how close you are and by how much you open or stop down your iris, measured in f-stops. So if it stops way down, you have a greater depth of field. But if I just want a shallow depth of field, I open my iris all the way up. It's almost kind of like a reverse kind of a thing, isn't it? A wide open iris, as open as it'll go, as open as the lens is wide, right, gives you a shallow depth of field. Only that much is in focus. But then you stop your iris all the way down, you're not letting in very much light, but interestingly enough, the science behind it is when you stop it down, you increase that depth of field and everything is in focus. And now, like public domain, you can use another person's work if they put it in Creative Commons. So there's this whole thing now that's been going on for I don't know how long, probably about 15 years, I'm gonna guess. And everyone knows about it now, but I didn't know about it growing up. And that is, this is in Creative Commons. This is allowed, this is something that I created and I want to share with everybody, and I'm a great guy. So look at what I did and you can do anything you want to with it. In post, what do you call the process used to enhance the color of an image? It's called color correction. Here's an example you can't probably see very well on the screen, but this is the raw footage. And it's got kind of a milky look about it. And then in color correction, they adjusted the contrast mostly, and they got everything that's kind of just, I don't know, in kind of the mid-tone area, they got it darker in contrast, and they made the sky bluer. Anyway, they made everything just pop a little bit better, sharpened it, But anyway, that's called color correction. Okay, let's do a review of the responsibility of the following cast and crew. Boy, am I going to keep this simple because you guys already know this. Camera operator. He's the one that composes the shots. Obviously, he's managing the camera. We just talked about focus and depth of field. He's controlling how much light comes into the camera. So that's what he does. He's in control of the shots and the way the shots look. The director is in control of the overall dramatic content of what's going on. Of course, he manages the crew and the cast, but he's interpreting that script, and he's trying to turn it into an emotional story that will convey that story to the audience and capture the audience's interest. The editor, they're in post-production, right? They're the ones that take all the shots, they edit them together, they assemble them into sequences that make sense, and they probably do some other post-production work on those shots, typically. The actor, of course, performs in front of the camera. They're telling the story to the audience. And the audio engineer, of course, in control of the sound, making sure that the sound is loud enough and that there's not any unwanted noise. Okay, we're going to do a review of microphone pickup patterns. So, I'll just let you look up there on the screen and guess what I'm doing here. If this is a handheld mic just like it looks like, and I'm talking like this, it's going to pick me up just fine. But as soon as I start to go off axis, you start to lose me again. You can hear what I'm saying again because I come back on. Which one is this? That's right, it's a cardioid. I guess they're trying to suggest like cardiovascular, like a heart, that's kind of a heart shape. All right, this typical pickup pattern will maybe reach out about 10 inches and then it really drops off fast. They call that the proximity effect. Cardioid's probably one of the most common microphones and slightly more affordable than these others. A directional microphone is the same thing. A cardioid is directional because you can't hear me this way. Yeah, I have to be in front of the mic somewhere. But it's just even more intense. So a directional microphone, like a shotgun microphone, we call it, a boom mic, a hypercardioid mic. If this was a hypercardioid, it would just pick up even further, from 10 inches to maybe 2 feet. And that's what this is. This is a little shotgun mic here, a supercardioid or hypercardioid mic, and it'll pick up maybe 2 to 3 feet even. Okay. It has this little weird kind of science stuff where it also tends to pick up a little bit like this. They'll show different kind of graphs on that. But really the whole point is to say it'll pick up out here like a lightsaber. And then omnidirectional. If this only picks up in this direction, more or less, right? What does omni mean? All directional. Omnipotent means all powerful. So omnidirectional means it picks up in every direction. And this is suggesting a little lavalier microphone that you clip on yourself right here. If this mic was omnidirectional, I could talk like right here and it would still pick me up. And we do have one microphone that you can just stick right in the middle of a table, have everyone surround the table, and everyone will be picked up fairly equally with an omnidirectional mic. What do you call it when the angle of your shot is tilted 45 to 90 degrees? That's called a Dutch angle. Why would you ever do that? Why don't you always want to be squared straight up? Well, you certainly do in almost everything you shoot in real life. Could you imagine, again, shooting a sports event and having the angle like that? If I'm playing soccer and I'm dribbling the ball up the field, it could be literally looking like it's up the field. It's an uphill battle for the Eagles today. A Dutch angle is used to kind of disorient the viewer or to maybe suggest something. In this particular case, maybe he looks a little more menacing because you did that. So it's whatever you're trying to communicate artistically. Color temperature is measured in Kelvin. Who remembers the science of color temperature? Okay, so it's measured in Kelvin, which means you'd put a K here, 2000 K, 3000 K, 4000, 5000, 6000. Cameras are set for this area very typically, and it's related to white balance. Remember we talked about that? So if you don't have your white balance set correctly, you'll have your color temperatures wrong. And if I set my color temperature to 3000, and maybe I'm shooting under some incandescent yellowish bulbs in here, and then I go outside, all of my footage, if I don't reset my white balance, all of my footage will look blue. And then if I reset it to, it actually should say daylight here. It says sunlight, but it should say daylight. But if I set it out here, this is suggesting it's kind of right in the middle of noon, you know, just a full-on sun and everything is just bright. And you're at about 5,500K. And then I come back inside and I shoot without adjusting my white balance and everything looks orange. So it's just kind of an opposite kind of a thing. I know this is like strange math. I'm only going to ask you to remember a couple things. I want you to remember tungsten, and that tungsten is 3,200K in this range. Usually we just say 3,200K. And that noonday daylight, again, remember the term daylight, daylight is 5,500K in that range. But I'm going to just have you try to remember these two. 5,500K if you're shooting outside in daylight. If you're shooting at sunset, though, then you make your color temperature this. You make your white balance to adjust for this color temperature. But if you're shooting out kind of middle of the day, full sky, maybe even a little bit overcast, you would set it to what they call daylight, roughly 5,500K. If you're shooting indoors, especially with kind of yellowish lights, or if you're shooting at sunrise or sunset, as the song goes, you're at about 3,200K, and that's called, who remembers it? Tungsten. Brand new vocabulary terms, but that's all you really need to know. And of course, automatic white balance works pretty well until you master it. All right, so that is what I asked you to do. What is tungsten sunrise color in Kelvin? 3,200K. What is noon daylight? Also just called daylight in Kelvin. 5,500. Sometimes you hear 5,600. I'll just say 5,500. I think it's probably easier to remember. Okay, in low light, you may have to increase your gain or ISO. I'm having you write that down. ISO is what we call it again if we're shooting on a still camera. But if we're not capturing still photos, then we call it gain on usually a video camera. But that's what you have. If you have low light, you have to adjust your gain or your ISO. But if you adjust it too much, if you try to amp up your gain too much, you're going to have a grainy, noisy picture. Gain or ISO, interchangeable. Who remembers the other one that was interchangeable between a still photo camera and a motion video? Aperture and... you forgot. Well, I'll let you go back and look. All right, now we're in post-production. And we take this shot because we kind of like it. It looks a little bit like we're on our way in the Lord of the Rings to Mordor. Except it also looks like a golf course, so we're going to go do some masking. And so the concept is that we mask out this background here so we can put in something that looks more menacing. And after we masked it out and did some color correction and some other compositing, now we put in a gray sky with clouds and lightning. When you add a sound to your scene that would not naturally be there, it is called a non-diegetic sound. I've worked in sound. I've produced a lot of sound for documentaries and TV and films, and I never heard that term until I started teaching. I don't know, I might have heard the term, we just didn't use it in the industry, but I'm sure it's just because I didn't travel in those circles. So it could be you've got a scene, and then for comedic value, let's say it's a scene from The Office or Seinfeld or something, you know, whatever. And then for comedic value, you hear a narrator, a voice from heaven. Mr. Walker, your class is falling asleep, right? That's not really what the sound would be in that environment, so it's a non-diegetic sound. What do you call the type of lens that does not zoom? It's called a prime lens. So it's very useful to have a camera that can zoom in on things, right? Why would you ever have a prime lens that won't zoom? It's just one focal length. Some of those lenses are very expensive. A prime lens can run $2,000-$3,000 easily on a good cinema camera. And one of the reasons why you'd have a prime lens is if you had a 55 millimeter lens, that happens to be the focal length that we kind of see naturally. Our eyes are pretty much 55 millimeter eyeballs. So we don't see really wide angle, we don't see telephoto, we just kind of see, well, like we would call it, just kind of a natural in between. And if you're doing documentary work, that's maybe exactly what you want. Just leave that 55 millimeter prime lens on your camera and go film a war zone. Or go film people at a hospital suffering with COVID-19. That's exactly the way the human eye would see it. 55 millimeter prime lens. What do you call pulling focus between subjects in a frame? This is what separates the amateurs from the professionals. When you're pulling your focus and you've got different people talking, so she's talking, so you're focused on her and everyone else is a little bit out of focus, then he's talking, then she's talking, then the horse in the background whinnies. I'm just making that up. If you can do that, that's called rack focus, and it makes the viewer focus on what subject you want them to focus on.
So why use a rack focus? In film and television, rack focuses range from barely noticeable to extremely obvious and eye-catching. Rack focuses also work great for conversations where one character is placed in front of the other. Racking back and forth between each character is a simple and effective way to film the scene.
So wherever you pull your rack focus, and by the way, a focus puller is actually a full-time gig on a film crew. They can make $1,000 a day just by having the DP, the director of photography, cinematographer, camera operator, telling them, please, this is what I want my rack focus to do. And then he adjusts it, and sometimes it's literally like swinging the focus. Very valuable skill to have, and it tells your story visually rather than just with the audio. Okay, what do you use as a light source where there is no electricity? The old joke was, well, you just plug into a current bush. Get it? Alternating current. Currents are berries. You guys don't even get it. What do you think this is? This is for outdoor use because it will reflect the sun and it gets bigger. Oh, I just took out a student. So again, my photography students have probably used this before. You can put a little bit of bounce, that's another thing they call it. You can bounce a little bit of light just off of this if you don't want too much. You probably can't tell from where you are, but it's bouncing some light back on my face. Or you can bounce more. We also have a silver side. That'll reflect more onto my face if you can see it. See if I can reflect it right back on you guys. There you go. How do you like that? That's a reflector. What do you call the plot motion that takes you to the climax? So we are, oh, let's go again with a war story. We're gonna climb that hill and come over the top and kill the enemy. That whole climbing of the hill, we'll say, is called rising action. So basically, you start with some characters, you explain what the story is gonna be about, you have some kind of conflict, somehow, guys, we got to get to the top of that hill, and then we'll be able to kill the enemy and mount our microphone or flag or flower. Okay, so that would be the climax when we are able to do that. We have taken this hill, all right? But everything, all the conflicts, all the drama that leads up to us getting to the top of the hill, appropriately, is called rising action. What do you call it when your subject is dark against a bright background? That's a very difficult word to spell. Silhouette. It's got to be French. There's a beautiful picture of a seagull against, I'd like to be there right now. Against a nice little sunset sun out on the ocean. Picture me standing here in the beach. Well, don't picture me, but because maybe I've got white legs. But there I am enjoying life, and I look up and I see the subject is dark against a bright background. That's called being in silhouette. If you shoot your video at 60 frames per second and play it back at 30 frames per second, you will get the effect of swimming in motion. No, slow. Slow motion. Okay, so I'll use my handy dandy reference here, index cards. If you remember, we were talking about frames per second. So in the old days, you literally had photos, and they went past at frames per second, however many frames, right? So if I shoot 60 frames per second, and it kind of goes about this fast when I shoot it, but I play it back at 30 frames per second, and so it kind of goes this fast. Boy, wasn't that a great example? You would have slow motion. when the camera follows along with the motion of the subject. That's called a tracking shot. And it literally comes from putting down tracks on the ground and then having a choo-choo train on those tracks that has a camera. It's not really a choo-choo train. You'll have some kind of a dolly that you put on those tracks, and then you move that dolly along on the tracks. It used to be really expensive. There's other ways to do tracking shots now, but gosh, to actually have the track, and the track would maybe follow around like, you know, I don't know, I'm gonna kind of walk through the classroom and have a tracking shot that follows me almost like on an S-curve or something. Those systems probably started at $10,000. And now you can do various things. I could even use this as a tracking shot. My wheeled podium. I put the camera on it and I just track and I follow the motion, okay? Don't get it confused with a trucking shot. Trucking is just literally a camera direction. Tracking can go anywhere on any track. Well, now you're prepared for the advanced section of the state test 2. Enjoy.